Now on BBC One, a specially extended edition of the 10 o'clock news from London and Singapore.
The International Olympic Committee has the honour of announcing that the Games of the 30th Olympiad in 2012 are awarded to the city of London. To the city of London.
Jubilation in London and in Singapore as the Olympic race is won. Britain's vision of reconnecting youth with sport wins the day and ministers rejoice.
Well, it's not often in this job that you sort of punch the air and do a little jig and embrace the next person standing next to you.
But in Paris, the long-standing favourite, there's silence and dismay. We'll have all the reaction in Singapore and here at home. Also tonight, the world's richest nations gather for the G8 summit at Gleneagles. But outside, there are dozens of arrests as police clash with demonstrators.
In BBC London News, Stratford celebrates as the Olympic dream becomes reality. And just what won the bid behind the scenes with the capital's victorious team in Singapore?
Good evening. The Olympic Games will come to London in 2012. After a tense voting session earlier today, London eventually beat Paris by just 4 votes. The building work in East London will start almost immediately as the Games return to the city for the first time since 1948. The voting session was held in Singapore and Dermot Murnaghan is there.
Well, as you say, Hugh, this was the narrowest of wins, but the implications for British sport are immense. Here in Singapore, Sebastian Coe and his London team could hardly contain their delight. He said the city was taking home the biggest prize in sport. Now, one by one, the bids of Moscow, New York and Madrid had fallen by the wayside, and then London faced Paris in a dramatic final vote. Ben Brown has the story of London's remarkable win.
London's day of destiny. And it began with a passionate last appeal from the British bid leader, Lord Sebastian Coe.
Mr. President.
His message, with words and emotional videos, was that the Games in London would regenerate a rundown part of the city and inspire young people all around the world.
On behalf of the youth of today, the athletes of tomorrow, and the Olympians of the future, we humbly submit the bid of London 2012.
I declare that the vote is now open.
When the voting started, even British government ministers could hardly bear the tension. Some of the London team almost dared not look. In each round, the city with the least votes dropped out. So, one by one, the early losers fell away.
The city of Moscow will not participate in the next round.
The city of New York will not participate in the next round.
Madrid will not participate in the next round.
The London team cheered when they heard they'd made it through to a final duel with Paris, the two old rivals head to head. Then, at last, the big announcement.
The International Olympic Committee has the honour of announcing that the Games of the 30th Olympiad in 2012 are awarded to the city of London.
The British bid team went wild with delight. Photographers who'd been expecting a French victory scurried over to the surprise winners. As everyone had predicted, this race was desperately close. London won by just 54 votes to 50. But they got the gold, and in this Olympic contest, there's no silver or bronze for the runners-up. Some of the French cried tears of disappointment and disbelief. This is the third time in recent years they've been turned down. And tonight they're devastated, while the British, of course, are delighted.
How do you feel?
I'm ecstatic. Mike. Absolutely ecstatic.
Surprised? Not surprised, quite shocked.
I really think the team have earned it. I mean, they've done a fantastic job. It's a very good team, and they really deserve the opportunity to run the games.
That team's backroom staff had been waiting for the news in a nearby Singapore restaurant. We join them there to hear the announcement.
To the city of London.
For the London team here, victory tastes all the sweeter tonight because they know they've come from behind and overtaken the French front runners. Many of these people celebrating here right now have worked for years and years to bring the Games to London in 2012. This really is the culmination of their dreams, and they're determined to enjoy it.
Some of the London team wept as they called loved ones back home. They've put everything into this bid. Tonight, they're exhausted and elated in equal measure.
Can I just ask, how much does this mean to you?
Like, I cannot expect a better moment than that ever in my life.
I hope to compete in the 2012 Games in London. We've done it, we've done it, we've done it. Yes!
And to prove they've done it, Lord Coe received the official contract giving London the 2012 Olympics. Then he came over to join his staff for a night of celebrations. He thanked everyone on his team, from the Princess Royal and the Mayor of London downwards.
Just now, the party of all parties. Thank you so much.
And what party could be complete without David and Victoria Beckham dropping in? The East End boy told me he's thrilled the Olympics are coming home to his part of London.
David, BBC, can we just ask you what this means for you personally?
Personally, I think for the whole country, not for me personally. I think the whole country has got to be proud today because there's a lot of hard work that's gone into this bid and it's paid off tonight.
And the London team are celebrating through the night, but they know that tomorrow the hard work begins of keeping their promise to create a Games in 2012 that will go down as one of the great Olympics. Ben Brown, BBC News, Singapore.
Well, news of London's victory was greeted with celebrations in Trafalgar Square, where thousands had gathered to watch the ceremony on a giant screen. There was also a victory party in East London, where the Olympic Village will be built, as James Munro reports.
In Trafalgar Square, under the gaze of Lord Nelson, thousands waited in hope for news of another famous victory.
At the Games of the 30th Olympiad in 2012 are awarded to the city of London.
Here were ordinary people swept up in one extraordinary moment. And this was London's response to those who said she didn't even want the Games.
Absolutely amazing. I mean, really, the feeling of it, because the Olympic spirit is so passionate, you know, and I think the country is just going to do wonders for everybody, and especially like the youth and today. I think it's just going to change our country around so much.
Oh, my God!
London was riding a wave of euphoria. Everyone, it seemed, was caught up in the mood.
Well, it's not often in this job that you sort of punch the air and do a little jig and embrace the next person standing next to you. So, you know, there are...
Above London, the red arrows filled the skies with red, white and blue. A vapour trail of triumph stretching all the way to Stratford in East London, the venue for the 2012 Olympics.
These people, this city, have been handed the opportunity of a lifetime. No wonder they're still celebrating, because not only have they been given the Olympic Games, they get a legacy which will transform this region.
You know, in every competition, all you have to do is you present your case properly and then have the greatest push and you will make it.
I'm very excited, really excited. I'm really happy as well, because at least we won, at least we can, you know, represent our country in a good way.
London's joy wasn't just confined to the East End. This was Waterloo Station. Scenes which were mirrored in Weymouth, where they'll host the sailing. The Olympics may be going to London, but the whole country will feel their impact. James Munro, BBC News.
Well, among those following every twist of London's Olympic bid was our sports correspondent, Adam Parsons. We can talk to him now. Well, Adam, as we were saying, it was incredibly tight. What do you think swung it in the end, in the final analysis for London?
Well, London came here with a very good technical bid, but they weren't alone in that. Certainly Paris had a bid that on paper looked just as strong. I think there were three things that the London team had here that really pushed them through. One was the presentation they put forward today. It was bold, it was pretty innovative, and it sent out a strong message, and that played very well with the IOC. They also had Lord Sebastian Coe. He's a very, very popular figure within the IOC, and they think that he's invigorated this bid. They think he's a man they can trust. But the name you keep hearing here when you talk to the IOC delegates, the members, is the Prime Minister. They were frankly bowled over by the fact that he'd taken 2 days out of his schedule just before the G8 summit to come and lobby them. They compared that to, say, President Chirac, and they felt that, frankly, he'd shown a loyalty, a desire and a commitment. And I think that may well have been the key factor in swinging this towards London.
And Adam, talk us through those voting patterns. Did it necessarily go as predicted, with first Moscow and then New York ejected, as expected?
Well, on paper, yes, but the bottom line is that Moscow went out in the first round. We all thought that would happen, but they went out with 15 votes. That's an awful lot more than most people thought. Bearing in mind, London won that round with just 22. That's not much of a spread, so it was a lot tighter than many of us had anticipated. And the other thing was that although we'd all build this as a London-Paris race, Madrid really, really were a strong contender. Going into the penultimate round, London, Paris and Madrid. Madrid were only knocked out by two votes. There are many people here who think that if it had been London and Madrid going down the final straight, it might not have been the same good news for London.
Well, Adam, thank you very much indeed. And that's it from us in Singapore. Back to Huw in London.
Dermot and Adam, thank you very much for that. Well, President Chirac said he was extremely disappointed with the decision, but he had sent his congratulations to the Queen and to Tony Blair. As Alan Little reports now, after 3 years of lobbying and such a narrow final margin, many French found the result rather difficult to accept.
They came expecting a party. There were to be fireworks, confetti, a military brass band. Parisians had grown used to speaking of when the Olympics come to town, not if. By the moment of truth, there were more than 10,000 people in the square. And when it hit them, it did so almost with the force of a physical blow.
At the Games of the 30th Olympiad in 2012 are awarded to the city of London.
Well, that has come as a devastating blow here. Paris has been in the meeting from the very beginning. They wanted the Games, the people were behind them, and a tremendous amount of national pride.
The shock of losing will only add to what is already a deep-seated mood of national despair. France's economy is stagnant. Its political leadership is unpopular. The one thing France had that united the country in optimism was the Olympic bid.
France is not doing good at all, clearly. We have to reinvent a social model, we have to reinvent ambition, we have to reinvent dynamism, and we're not doing good in doing that. So, and we did not need, at this point, this failure.
Jacques Chirac flew the humbled French tricolour into Scotland tonight. His standing at home has never been lower.
Et je suis naturellement...
Like all Frenchmen, he said, I'm disappointed, but I look forward to congratulating the Queen and Tony Blair personally. Paris now rolls away its Olympic dream, and tonight, one last indignity, a Eurostar train rolling into Paris, flying the flag of London's success. From Waterloo, with commiserations. Alan Little, BBC News, Paris.
Staging the Olympics in London will call for a massive construction programme, most of it in East London. Over £2 billion will be invested, some of which will be paid for by extra council tax in the capital. Our economics editor, Evan Davis, looks at the costs and benefits of hosting the Games.
You'll be seeing more of this area in the next few years, a rundown section of East London.
So you can see there's a bit of work to be done, bit of landscaping, before we can call the project a success. That work will cost money, so don't be surprised that just as crowds were jumping for joy in Trafalgar Square today, a similar thing was going on in the city with the shares of construction companies.
For example, have a look at the share price of construction firm Balfour Beatty through today, before the announcement and then after the announcement. It rose 4%. So what about the costs of the Games? Work is already underway, completion of the fast rail link to Paris. But we were building this with or without the Olympics, so it isn't really a new cost. New construction work, though, now has a deadline.
There's a risk that the need to meet the Olympic deadline will raise the cost substantially above what it need be, as we saw indeed with the case of the Athens 2004 Olympics.
The Athens Games costs did overrun, so now consider the benefits. Benefits are not so evident in the legacy of the facilities, here they are now, but Greece is delighted at the change in perception of the country.
The benefit is immense. Of course, this benefit is not always tangible and immediate. And on the other hand, of course, the cost of organising Games and preparing all the construction work necessary is also very big.
London too can expect big costs and benefits, entrenching it as a global hub. But what about the rest of the country? Will East London now suck in resources from elsewhere, or will good news trickle through the country? In Birmingham today, they cheered London's success, assuming there'll be spillover benefits for all.
Hopefully we'll play a part in accommodating people that are going to the Olympics, but also there's going to be other people coming into Britain as part of the Olympic celebrations and the Year of Sport, and Birmingham will get part of that market.
You can't really do a precise calculation of the costs and benefits of hosting the Olympics. A lot of the costs of redevelopment in this area would have occurred anyway. And as for the benefits, you can't measure them all in pounds and pence. If the nation is genuinely excited by the prospect, well, that's worth a lot of work and a lot of concrete. Evan Davis, BBC News, in the soon-to-be Olympic Village.
Well, today's vote was the culmination of years of campaigning and lobbying, and as we've heard, four rounds of voting were needed before London was eventually declared the winner. Anita McVeigh looks back at the winning campaign. What have you done
today to make you feel proud? London's race to win the 2012 Olympics began in earnest a little over 2 years ago. But within weeks, doubts appeared. Why, many people asked, had American businesswoman Barbara Cassani been appointed to lead the British bid? A year later and London makes it onto the shortlist of candidate cities.
London,
but is criticised by the International Olympic Committee for poor transport and an apparent lack of public support. Then double Olympic gold champion Lord Coe replaces Cassani as chairman. The campaign intensifies earlier this year in a crucial four-day visit by IOC members. The 2012 campaign hopes the royal touch will leave a lasting impression.
So things were looking more favourable at this stage, but London was still trailing behind Paris. So what exactly happened in the last few weeks, days and even hours to swing the vote and bring the Games here?
It is a decision about which bid offers the vision and sporting legacy to best promote the Olympic cause.
Part of the answer lies in the leadership of Sebastian Coe, his political and Olympic pedigree a winning combination.
I think Seb Coe was very important. He's a wonderful athlete and he gave a very inspirational presentation.
But it was also a team effort, with the bid stressing London's multicultural appeal and strong Paralympic tradition. And with just four votes in it, this film showing children inspired by a London Olympics and viewed by the IOC just before the vote may have proved decisive. Its makers hope so.
It was so, so moving. And I think that's what the film is all about. It's by grabbing the audience by the heart rather than the head.
With one race over, another begins. The finish line in 2012. Anita McVeigh, BBC News.
The day's other main news is that leaders of the world's richest nations have arrived at Gleneagles for the G8 summit. Tonight they've been attending a dinner hosted by the Queen. The main summit business starts tomorrow with aid to Africa and tackling climate change on top of the agenda. Our World Affairs John Simpson, editor John Simpson, is there.
If you think about it, it's an odd way of kicking off a major international summit. But Tony Blair has linked up with Bob Geldof, with Bono and the others, to ratchet up the pressure on the G8. He's taking a big risk. George Bush, whose helicopter landed on the sacred golf course itself, is the main leader they have to convince, though not the only one. He feels he's done a lot already, promising to double US aid to Africa and halve the deaths from malaria. And for now, he's not giving anything more on global warming either. And he's not the only one who'll have to be convinced. Mr. Koizumi, the Japanese Prime Minister, with his Bob Geldof hairdo, is strongly resistant to extra aid for Africa. So are the Canadians. Tony Blair's got his work cut out.
I'll push them the whole way. Do you ever get everything you ever want? In negotiations like this, no. But can we make very substantial progress? Can we change the terms of debate on Africa? Yes, we can.
Geldof and Bono went off to meet President Bush and several of the other leaders. Again, a total break with G8 tradition. Afterwards, they were pretty somber.
What kind of ideas did you get them from them as you were talking to them?
There isn't a deal. It's still to play for. I have a sense of tension and not complacency at all.
Later, in the Gleneagles grounds, a brief moment of drama. President Bush, out on a bike ride, went too fast and managed to collide with a British policeman. The policeman went to hospital. The White House admits it's not the first time Mr. Bush has fallen off his bike. But he turned up with his wife Laura for the formal dinner hosted by the Queen tonight, despite the scrapes to his hands and arms. The leaders sat for their group photograph, cheerfully enough. And if Jacques Chirac was worried about the cooking at the dinner to come, he didn't show it. For Tony Blair, it'll be a testing couple of days. He may have won the Olympics, but winning the G8 will be a great deal harder. John Simpson, BBC News, Gleneagles.
Beyond the security barrier around Gleneagles, there have been a series of clashes between police and protesters. Riot police had to force back several hundred demonstrators who'd managed to break through a section of security fencing. Gavin Hewitt has been following the day's events.
At one stage today, police had cancelled the march to the perimeter of the Gleneagles Hotel, fearing violence, but later they relented. But some of the marchers broke away from the agreed route and walked across a field towards where the summit was being held. They managed to pull down part of the main security fence. Some of them attacked a police observation tower. With police falling back, RAF Chinook helicopters were called in, dropping off reinforcements. For a period, there were fierce clashes with protesters.
This is exactly what the police fear, that they wouldn't be able to hold the line. They've had to break out of Gleneagles, not just with dogs, but with batons and with horses.
Hundreds of police were used to clear the fields. Only a minority of marchers were involved in any trouble. But once again, an opening day of a G8 summit was disfigured by violence.
Unfortunately, some people chose not to keep to the route that had been agreed, and that's why you got the number of people in the field. We responded to that in a professional manner.
Clashes had begun at 5 o'clock this morning in the town of Stirling. Masked anarchists hurled rocks at police lines. Some of the fighting was in a residential neighbourhood. Car windows were smashed and police vehicles attacked. Later, groups of protesters blocked main roads. Trees were cut down. During the day, there were 165 arrests. As roads were closed, other non-violent protesters were forced to walk for 7 hours to get close to Gleneagles.
Police were blockading the place today, apparently, so we decided it was better to walk across the hills, get here by any means, so they couldn't stop us.
At times during this turbulent day, police walked a fine line between preventing disruption and denying protesters their civil liberties. I don't mind at all. tonight in Edinburgh, 60,000 people turned up for a Live Aid concert backing the campaign to make poverty history. Bob Geldof told the crowd that although solutions wouldn't come overnight, they had brought the issue of African poverty to the table. This seemed a world away from today's protests. Gavin Hewitt, BBC News, Edinburgh.
One of the themes of the summit, promoting trade with Africa, is being followed with interest in Swaziland, where sugar is the country's main industry. Suppliers are warning